Tensions between the U.S. and Iran, as we just mentioned, have been heating up over the past few weeks as the one-year anniversary approached of the American killing of a top Iranian general in Iraq. Militias there with ties to Iran still want revenge. This past weekend, Iraqis converged and demonstrated their opposition to the United States. NewsHour special correspondent Jack Hewson has this report from Baghdad.
Thousands gathered at Baghdad's Tahrir Square to mark the one-year anniversary of the killing of Qassem Soleimani by an American drone strike on Baghdad's airport road. Soleimani ran much of Shia Iran's military operations in the region as head of the elite Quds Force. Reviled as a terrorist by the US and many in the region, he was celebrated in equal measure by others. Riding with him that night was Abu Mahdi al-Muhandis, the deputy leader of Iraq's Popular Mobilization Forces, a collection of largely Shia paramilitaries, many of them with strong ties to Iran. The PMF were instrumental in the fight against the Sunni extremists of ISIS, and for PMF supporters like Hussein Ali, the killings are a point of great bitterness.
After this achievement and the Iraqi victory over ISIS, America came to kill these two leaders.
The US kept troops in country following the 2018 destruction of the ISIS caliphate inside Iraq to press the offensive against the remnants of the group. Of equal importance, though, using Iraq as a strategic base against Iran. Rocket attacks against US-staffed installations began to increase.
Very few people want to take responsibility for the rocket attacks against the American embassy, but as you can see from the public opinion here, there is significant appetite for more of it. President Trump has said if one American is killed in the course of these attacks, then there will be reprisals. And as long as that's the case, there could be significant escalation.
The assassination was the peak of a series of strikes and counter-strikes between the US and Iran and pro-Iranian groups in late 2019 and early last year, a proxy conflict on Iraqi soil. In response, the Iraqi parliament passed a non-binding resolution to eject US troops.
We want these decisions implemented. The people voted on the decision to remove the American forces, and we want to remove all the American forces peacefully. But if they're not achieved by peaceful means, then the people will resist.
With 2,500 US troops still in country, that resistance is made reality by continued attacks on convoys and lands in the form of rocket attacks launched on the US embassy in Baghdad. The US reportedly threatened to evacuate its embassy here, among the largest in the world, last fall. The last attack was on December 20th, as 8 rockets were fired at the US embassy. Red traces from the embassy's defense system returned fire. No group has claimed responsibility, but government forces arrested members of a prominent pro-Iranian faction called Asaib al-Alhaq, or AAH. In response to the arrest, masked men claiming to be members of AAH made threats against the Iraqi Prime Minister, Mustafa al-Kadhimi, posted on social media. AAH spokesperson Mahmoud al-Rubai denied the group's involvement either with the attack or the video threats, and said that one of their arrested associates had been forced to confess.
They tortured him in order to extract a confession from him that he is a participant in this operation and that works with rockets. This matter is all a lie. There is nothing of this subject.
The Iraqi security forces denied claims of torture, but the topic of who is behind the attacks against Americans in Iraq is of ongoing debate among Baghdad's community of political and security analysts, Sajjad Jihad, a fellow at the Century Foundation.
Certainly, that's what we've seen throughout 2020, that, you know, the smaller, newer kind of groups that have been established outside the PMF framework, there's been concern that there's not enough command and control over these groups and the fact that they seem to be a bit more dangerous and reckless.
And these new subgroups may not be acting in the interests of Iran. Soleimani's replacement, Ismail Khani, visited Iraq in November and is reported to have discouraged paramilitaries from attacking US bases in the last days of the Trump administration.
I don't think they want to escalate. I don't think the Iranians are in that position at this moment. I think it's important for the Iranians to have that balance between keeping pressure up on the US, meeting the demands and the messaging for domestic purposes, and also reminding, you know, and giving space to the next US administration to, you know, enter into serious negotiations with them.
It's that delicate balance and capacity for miscalculation that has many here and in the region still on edge. For PBS NewsHour, I'm Jack Hewson in Baghdad.
And to discuss that tension further, I'm joined by Nick Schifrin. So, Nick, we know there were no attacks over the anniversary this weekend, but Iran has made two significant moves, and so has the State Department today.
Yeah, the Iranian Revolutionary Guard Corps seized a South Korean-flagged oil tanker, and Iran enriched up to 20% uranium at its Fordo nuclear plant. That lowers the so-called breakout time if Iran wanted to create a nuclear weapon. Both moves, Judy, remind the incoming Biden administration of Iran's leverage points and priorities ahead of expected diplomatic talks. But the Trump administration's not done yet. It sanctioned 17 Iranian companies today on top of 1,500 people and entities already sanctioned.
So, Nick, then looking over the last few days, what steps did the U.S. take in advance of the Soleimani killing anniversary, and how high was the concern?
Senior administration, military, and Iraqi officials told me they were very concerned that a militia in Iraq would attack the U.S. And so the administration was trying to send a unified message of deterrence to Iran. First, there was a presidential Twitter threat, and then a rare photo released by the Navy of a submarine sailing off Iran's coast, and then B-52s sent to the Middle East. But after that, the Pentagon ordered the Nimitz aircraft carrier home from the Middle East. A senior military official says, tells me that the decision was made over the advice of military leaders who said bringing the Nimitz home would send Iran mixed signals. Administration officials say they were trying to send a calibrated message that the U.S. would respond militarily if Iran did attack and kill a U.S. service person, but it didn't actually want to go to war. But then, Judy, the mixed messages got even more mixed. The Pentagon announced that the Nimitz would stay in the region after all. A military official tells me that the White House made a last-minute decision that surprised even the Pentagon. I've talked to independent analysts about all this back and forth, and they say this is, frankly, bordering on incompetent. And a senior administration official admits to me that there wasn't any strategic sense behind suddenly keeping the Nimitz in the region because there was no new intelligence that would require it to stay. But bottom line, Judy, the Nimitz remains in the region, as do the tensions between the U.S. and Iran.
Well, a lot of drama and so much to follow in these first days of the new year. Nick Schifrin, thank you very much.
Thank you.